Guys, Philly Diva coming to you, and a week or so ago I had shared with you guys one of my favorite stories from one of my favorite books, which is the Holy Bible. And I shared with you guys a story about being faithful, and surprisingly a lot of you guys enjoyed the story. Of course, it was my interpretation of the story, but I was very surprised and very pleased to hear that some of you guys really enjoyed the story. So of course that made me even more motivated to share more stories with you guys, because you never really know how people are going to embrace change. And I know there's a lot of changes that are occurring on my channel, but I'm hoping that some of you guys are embracing it. Some people aren't. You got to deal with that on your own, but these are things that I like to talk about. And yeah, it made me really motivated to share more stories with you guys, because I tell these stories to my children and, you know, my other friends, and you guys are my YouTube family, so I wanted to share it with you guys also. So I decided today I wanted to share another story with you guys from my favorite book, which is the Holy Bible. And this story is about friendship, and friendship is a really, really touchy subject for me personally, for the simple fact I can probably count on one hand how many true friends I really have. I've had a lot of people come and go in my life that I thought were friends, but yeah, like I said, I can probably count on one hand how many true friends I currently have, and I'm very happy and with that circle of friends, and I love all my friends like they're my family. I don't even call them friends, I call them my sisters, so they are my family. So yeah, this story that I want to share with you guys today is about friendship, and hopefully you will get the underlining message of the story, the moral of the story, and hopefully you can take it with you and share it with someone else, or you can just use the information in your personal life. Okay, so again, this is my interpretation of the story, so bear with me. So this story is about Jonathan, who is King Saul's son, and his very, very good friend David. Okay, and David lived in the palace with Jonathan and King Saul. Okay, and Jonathan and David were like ace boon coon. Okay, they were BFFs, best friends forever. They made a promise to each other basically that they were going to be friends forever, and nothing and nobody would ever come between them. No females, no homies, no Shaniquas, no Ray Rays. Nobody was ever going to come between them. They were BFFs forever. So one day, David, he wanted to leave the palace, and he was afraid that King Saul wanted to kill him. But Jonathan, he was like, no, Dave, you my homie. He was like, I don't want you to go. Please don't go. He's like, my father's not going to hurt you. He was like, my dad tells me everything what he wants to do. So if he wanted to kill you, he would have told me this. But David was like, no, John, your pops is crazy, okay? He wants to kill me. So David was still afraid, and he knew that he was in serious danger. So King Saul really started to hate David because he was, you know, seeing all this stuff about him. And King Saul told his son Jonathan, he was like, look, I want you to kill him. I need you to kill David. But Jonathan loved David so, so much. He was like, my pops is tripping. I am not killing my homeboy, okay? So he had to make a plan. He had to make a plan to help his friend David. So there was this field not too far from where they are, and there was this really, really big stone in the field. So Jonathan said, listen, Dave, I want you to go in the field and hide behind this stone, okay? And then in 3 days, I'm going to come out there with one of my servants, okay? And we're going to shoot 3 arrows next to the stone, okay? And I'm going to tell my servant to go get the arrows. And if he says to you, bring them here, then you know it's safe and it's cool. You can come back. My pops ain't going to kill you. But if my servant goes and get the arrows and says, the arrows are beyond you, that means you need to run and get to stepping, because my pop wants to kill you, okay? So David went into the field like his friend planned, and he hid behind a stone. So then Jonathan went back to his father, King Saul, and he said, pops, please, 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 don't kill my friend David. I beg begging you, please. I love my friend. David is my best friend forever. He is my ace boon coon. So King Saul was like, whatever. I'm the king. I'm not feeling homie. I want him to be killed. So King Saul was not listening to his son. He wasn't listening to nobody. And he got so mad because Jonathan kept begging him like, please, 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 please don't kill my friend David. So King Saul got so mad, so angry, he threw his sword at his own son. Luckily, he missed. So Jonathan was like, whoa, my pops is really tripping now. Like, he could not believe it. So Jonathan started booking. He started running out the palace like, oh my God, my pops is crazy. David was right. So he went out to the field where the great stone was at. He shot the three arrows out to the stone. And the servant went to go get the arrows, just like he said. And the servant says, they are beyond you. So at that point, David heard the message and he was so sad because he knew, by hearing the message, they are beyond you, that means that it was danger. King Saul really wanted to kill him, and there was no way that he could ever go back to the palace and be with his friend. So Jonathan then went back out to the field, and he greeted his friend David, and he told him basically, look, Dave, my pops is crazy. You was right. He does have a plan to kill you. And he was like, I just really, really think you need to just go away and be safe. He said, please, I urge you, just go away and be safe. I love you so much, you're my homie, but I can't have my father kill you. So he said, just remember, no matter what happens, that we will always be friends, and I love you dearly. So David, he ran away. He found a cave nearby in the desert somewhere, and he lived there for a really, really long time. So the moral of the story is true friendship is forever, you guys. And I think far too often a lot of us don't realize that friendships are actual relationships, just like relationships we have with our husbands and our wives or our boyfriends or our girlfriends, whatever. These are serious. Friendships is a serious relationship, something that requires time, effort, energy. If you're going to be a friend to someone, you just can't befriend someone just because, you know, you have similar interests. You have to befriend with someone and you have to actually make that relationship work. You have to spend time with that person. Be there for that person. You know, give to that person without the expectation of getting something in return. You know, far too often a lot of people, you know, have friends and they do things for each other and they, you know, really think that they need to get something back. And that's not what true friendship is really about. As you can see in the story, Jonathan and David, Jonathan would have did anything for his friend David, even disobeying his own father. His father wanted him to kill him, but he loved his friend David so, so much, he would not do that. He wouldn't even obey his own father. That's how much of a friend he was to David. And the point is that when you have a friend like that, then you know it's forever. On a personal level, if I still have time, I want to share with you guys about one of my friendships, and I consider this a lifetime friendship because I've been friends with this person for a really, 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 really long, really long time, and probably longer than some of you guys have been alive. It's going on almost 20 years, and I remember this like the back of my hand, and I know she probably hate me for this, but when I had first started college in 1992, yeah, in 1992 is when I first started college, and I was on my own straight out of high school. I was like one of those, I can be on my own type of girl, I'm out of high school. So yeah, I was on my own straight out of high school. I enrolled in college not knowing anything about scholarships or financial aid, nothing like that. I was Miss Know-It-All, didn't know nothing. So my really good friend, she was a little older than me. She was already like out of college. She was established. She had a career going on. She was financially stable. She was the bomb. But she was my friend, and she never looked, you know, at me, you know, like she was above me or I was below her or anything like that. So one day she had came over to my house. I had this little rinky-dink apartment, and I was upset, and she knew I was upset just by the look on my face, and she was like, what's wrong? So I showed her my tuition bill, and at that time tuition wasn't as expensive as it is now. So I remember it wasn't exactly $1,300, but it was a little over $1,300 that I owed. So she was like, come on, let's take a ride. She had a car, she had everything, I ain't had nothing. So she was like, come on, let's take a ride. So we got in the car, we took a ride, and she went to the bank. So she went inside the bank, you know, I'm not thinking anything of it. So she comes back into the car and she hands me this envelope. And inside the envelope was $1,300. So I'm like, what is this? She's like, it's $1,300. And I'm like, girl, you are tripping. I'm not taking $1,300 from you. She said, yes, you are. And I'm like, no, I'm not. So that went on for like 5 minutes. So she was like, listen, if you don't take this money, I'm going to take it. I'm going to pay your college tuition for you. So I'm like, you know, at this point, so I took the $1,300 and I told her, I was like, look, you know, I'm working part time. I'm a full time student. I was broke. Okay. So I'm like, look, girl, I was like, I don't know how I'm going to repay you this. And I was like, I hate borrowing money from nobody. And she said, listen, repay me when you graduate. We both have the intentions on me graduating in 4 years, but it didn't work out that way. Doesn't always work out as you plan. So, do. 18 years later, I finally graduate from college. Yay. Of course, my BFF is at my college graduation. And, of course, it was a proud moment for me, for her, for everyone. So, it was an even more proud moment for me because I was able to pull out my checkbook and write my girlfriend a check for $1,300. So I gave her the check, you know, and, you know, we all celebrated. And I'm like, here. And she's like, what's this? And I was like, I owe you $1,300, remember? And she was like, for what? I said, remember when I first started school, you gave me $1,300? She was like, oh my God, are you serious? I was like, yes, I can't stand owing people money. So she was like, Diva, you are retarded. So she took the money, well, she took the check. And you know what she did with it? She tore it up in my face and threw it in my face. She said, are you kidding me? And she said, girl, I don't want that money back. And I said, well, why did you give it to me? She said, you really don't know why I gave you that money? And I said, no. She said, that's what friends are for. And I started crying like so I started crying more. Of course, I'm so sensitive. So I was like, so I mean, after we stopped crying, she said, she was like, girl, your repayment was you walking across that stage and getting your college degree. She said, that was the best repayment you could ever give me. And that made me so proud. Not that I had to give her the $1,300 back, but it just made me so happy that I had such a good friend for this many years to have my back no matter what. And, you know, she was just there for me through thick and thin no matter what. And she, not ever once did she ever say, you know you owe me $1,300. Never. Like, she totally forgot about it. I never forgot about it, but she forgot about it. And she basically told me, you know, that was my gift to her, my gift from her, and my gift to her was getting my degree. And yeah, we celebrated that night. So again, the moral of the story is, you guys, true friendships are forever. And I just want people to know that, you know, when you have a true friend, you know, you're not their friend because, you know, of their success. My friends, like I said, I consider my sisters. So, you know, if I'm successful, my sisters are successful. We never, you know, we're never jealous of each other. We always are proud of, you know, what we all achieve. We have each other's back no matter what. And I think, you know, that is important to have that kind of structure in your life, because it's really important that you know that you can't do it all by yourself. Everybody needs help once in a while. I mean, even the strongest of the strong needs help once in a while. And I mean, even though this was many, many years ago, you know, I would never ask her for that kind of money. I would never ask her for $13, let alone $1,300. But I never asked her. She gave it to me. And you know, I was so grateful for it. But yeah, when you have true friends, you don't lie to them, you don't steal from them, you don't sleep with their man, you don't blast them on Facebook or Twitter. I'm getting real personal now, y'all. You know, you don't be jealous or envious of their success. You don't do none of these things. You just be happy for them and be blessed that you have such a great friendship, a great relationship with this person, and you cherish it. You cherish it forever, because true friendship is so hard to come by. So hard to come by. And trust me, true friends, they say people come in your lifetime for a reason, a season, or a lifetime. True friends are there for a lifetime. And I can say my sister is there for a lifetime, and she feels the same way about me. I will be her friend forever. She takes care of me. She helps me with my children. She is my dog for life. And I hope that this story means something to somebody, and I hope my story means something to someone, that, you know, just cherish those kind of relationships, and, you know, make sure that you keep really good, positive people in your circles. Make sure you surround yourself with people who are there to uplift you, not to bring you down, and people who will rejoice in your success and not be envious of it, and people who will have your back forever.